Madhulika Kumar. She has completed her Master of Architecture in Architectural Association, London, UK. She then went on to work at Shanmugam Associates and Integrated Design on projects ranging from residences to regional planning, sustainable master planning, water calculation, etc. She was also known for her master thesis, which was selected for public display at AA, which was also selected for summer exhibition and shortlisted to publish at a national conference in UK.
Welcome to UGC lecture series for BE Architecture. Today's topic is Climate and Built Environment, Unit 3, Heat Flow Through Building Envelope Concepts, Lecture 06, Subject Code AR6303. Presentation outline. Presentation has been divided into three categories. First, introduction, and we move on to type of envelope, windows and glazing types. What is an envelope? The building envelope refers to the exterior facade and it's comprised of opaque components and fenestration systems. Opaque components include wall, roof, slab on grade, in touch with the ground, basement wall and opaque doors. So, whatever that has been external covering of your building is what is called as envelope. So, your exterior wall units, your roofs, your flooring and windows, fenest openings, apertures, whatever is being present on facing towards the exterior or in contact with the outdoor environment is called envelope. So, fenestration system includes windows, skylight, ventilator and doors that are more than one half glazed. The envelope protects the building interior and occupant from weather condition and shields them from other external factors, example noise, pollution, etc. Fenestrations like windows, skylight, glazed doors also contribute to envelope design, and all this presence of choosing your wall units, doors, ceilings, windows, all this contribute to the environmental factors and contributing to thermal comfort of the indoor spaces. Envelope design strongly affects the visual and thermal comfort of the occupant as well as energy consumption in the building. So, as we know, we have discussed in earlier presentations how U value and specific heat capacity, thermal conductance and thermal resistivity of a material is very important. So, all this contributes not only in creating good environment for your for the occupant on the indoors, but also it helps in saving your energy bills. From an energy efficient point of view, the envelope design must take into consideration both external and internal heat loads as well as daylight benefits. So, when external loads, which means the amount of solar radiation or relative humidity levels, wind speeds, wind direction, which is happening on the external, which causes the usage of additional energy sources to keep ourselves within thermal comfort. But also there is lot of internal loads which is acting inside the building, such as we are also dissipating heat towards the interior spaces. So, presence of number of occupants and presence of electrical appliances and the activity pattern that is being followed inside, all this contributes to the internal load of the envelope. The commonly considered elements of energy conservation building code envelope are walls, windows and roofs. So, all these elements contribute to energy efficiency of an envelope design. So, let us see walls. Walls are a major part of building. Envelope receives large amount of solar radiation. The heat storage capacity and heat conduction property of walls are key to meeting desired thermal comfort conditions. Appropriate thermal insulation and air cavities in wall reduce heat transmission into buildings which are primary aim in hot regions. So, depending on your climatic regions, you need to make sensible choices of your wall units. So, if your building is located in a hotter region, the outside temperature is very high and you do not need high temperature to come inside your interior. So, you need to make your walls in such a way, it will not conduct the thermal energy from outside to the interior. So, the basic elements of a wall system are exterior cladding, which is the cladding that you do facing towards the exterior of the building, and drainage panels. So, there is a small gap between these two units which forms the drainage plane, and air barrier systems, which is marked in number 3, this and this forms the air barrier systems, and vapor retardant to maintain certain amount of relative humidity levels, you might need vapor retardant, which is used for places which demands to maintain the amount of relative humidity in the air. And insulating elements, the insulation that is present in pink color, which is located little further away from your exterior cladding by an air cavity. This is to protect your interior spaces from your exterior harsh climatic conditions. And structural elements, so your columns or columns and beams which is contributing to contributing and intersecting with your walls are called structural elements. So thermal storage and thermal capacity. Thermal capacity is a measure of amount of heat required to raise the temperature of layer of material. It is a product of density multiplied by specific heat and the volume of construction material. So, how we discussed about specific heat capacity and thermal conductance conductivity of material in earlier presentation, thermal capacity means how much heat we require to increase the temperature of the entire construction system itself. So, say if it is completely for a floor, how much heat is required to increase its temperature. So, it is a multiplication of the density of the material, the mass and the layers that has been used. The main effect of heat storage within a building structure is to moderate fluctuation in the indoor temperature. So, the main aim to use heat storage material is to avoid from having fluctuations in the indoor temperature. So, if suddenly if the morning temperature outside is 40 degrees Celsius and the indoor is also 40, and during the night if it is 10 degrees Celsius and if it is indoor is also 10 degrees Celsius, human beings cannot adapt to such drastic differences at a short time. So, to avoid such fluctuations is why we are using heat capacity materials to store the heat and dissipate whenever it is required. Thermal performance of wall can be improved by following ways: increasing wall thickness, improving air cavity between wall and hollow masonry blocks, applying insulation on external surfaces, applying light colored distemper on the exposed side of the wall. If you want to increase your performance of the wall, if you are located in a very harsh climate which requires walls to be highly sealed to protect your interior from the exterior, you need to have good amount of thickness of the wall, and the material that you are going to choose must have a good U value, and also the air cavity which you are keeping between two elements in your wall has to be good enough that it reduces the heat transfer from exterior to the interior or interior to the exterior, depending on climate. And application of insulations on the external surfaces. If you want to protect your interior from exterior, it is ideal to keep your insulations outside facing the exterior. And applying light color distempers. If more darker the color you apply, more it will start to absorb the solar radiation. If you are located in a higher in a location in which has higher air temperature, you must paint your buildings in much more lighter color, so it doesn't absorb, or the heat capacity of white color is very less. And wall insulations, thermal insulation is of a great value when a building requires mechanical heating or cooling. Insulation helps reduce the space conditioning loads. So what is the use of insulation is, if you are using insulations, you are avoiding from your day to day fluctuations, which means the demand for heating, space heating or space cooling can be reduced due to its presence. Location of insulation and its optimum thickness are important. In hot climate, insulation is placed on the outer facing exterior of the wall, so that the thermal mass of the wall is likely coupled with the external source and strongly coupled with the interior. Depending on your location, if it is hot climate, the insulation is ideal if it is placed outside. If it is on the colder regions, it is ideal to keep the insulation on the interior. So, you need to protect the interior hotter temperature from the outside colder temperature, and it happens vice versa for a hotter climate region. Thermal properties of these materials are given below. So, these are different commonly used construction materials such as brick, mud, stone and timber. And different conductivity, specific heat capacity and density has been mentioned, which can be chosen according to the climatic zone that you are going to design for. Air cavities. Air cavities within walls are an active space in a roof ceiling combination reduce the solar heat gain factor, thereby reducing space conditioning load. The performance improves if the void is ventilated. So, if you are keeping an air cavity, that is almost like keeping a insulation. So, by keeping a small gap between two materials, you are actually protecting from the heat transfer that can happen from one element to the other element. This is very much beneficial if you are located in a very harsh climatic condition, and this air cavities can be ventilated if you are keeping it in on your roof like attic space, which can be used as a storage as well, and it can decouple from your external environments. Heat is transmitted through the air cavity by convection and radiation. A cavity represents a resistance which is not proportional to its thickness. So, cavity is like a resistance to added to a material to reduce the heat transfer between the two objects. For a thickness of more than 20 mm, the resistance of heat flow remains nearly constant. Ventilated air does not reduce radiative heat transfer from the roof to ceiling. So, this is ideally for roof to ceiling, you must have more than 20 mm of air cavity. The radiative component of heat transfer may be reduced by using low emissivity or high reflective coating. That is example aluminium foil on either surfaces facing the cavity. So, if you want to increase the performance of heat transfer that is going to happen in the air cavity, between if there is an air cavity and there is two elements, you can finish both the elements that is facing towards the air cavity by aluminium foil or any other highly reflective coating. With aluminium foil attached to the top of the ceiling, the resistance of downward heat flow increases to about 0.4 meter square K per watt. compared to 0.21 meter square K per watt in the absence of foil. So, this presence of aluminium foil can increase or trigger the heat flow that has been happening from the roof to your ceiling. So, next moving on to windows. Windows are very important components of building envelope in addition to providing physical and visual connection to outside. It also allows heat and light in and adds beauty to the building. So, window does not only performs or adds to the energy efficiency point of a building, but it also adds beauty to the building, and it also promotes good amount of daylighting to come in and natural ventilation to keep us in comfort levels, and also to keep us connected from the indoor to the outdoors. Solar radiation coming in through windows provide natural lighting, natural air and heat gain to the space inside, thus significantly impacting the energy usage of the building. Solar radiation which is penetrating through the building can be used beneficial in the parts in which passive solar heating is required, and it can be cut down in places which is experiencing higher summers. The main purpose of building and its window is to provide thermal and visual comfort to the occupants, and if this can be achieved using less energy, so much the better. So, this provides good amount of views and to keep you connected with the outdoor, and it also adds to visual comfort. So, if you are sitting within a closed environment for a longer duration, you will feel sick building syndrome. So, you must have your building must optically have at least a minimum amount of windows to keep you connected towards the exterior spaces. The recommendation according to IS 3362-1977 code of practice for the design of windows for light and ventilation, there should be sufficient air motion in hot and humid and warm and humid climates. So, the presence of openings or windows becomes very much important in hot and humid or warm and humid climates, in which humidity level will start increasing if the air is getting trapped within a space. So, there must be constant air exchange happening because of the presence of huge openings or fenestrations. In such areas, fan are essential to provide comfort. Air motion indoors and fenestrations having 15% to 20% of the floor area are found adequate in both ventilation and daylighting in hot and dry and hot and humid regions. So, there must be constant air motion present within the occupied environment. So, ideally the window should not be less than 15% or 20% of your floor area to maintain constant air changes. So, this is ideal for hot and dry and hot and humid climates, and fan becomes very, very much essential because the air speed or air velocity that is present in these climatic conditions are comparatively lesser. Natural light is also admitted into building through glazed opening. Thus, fenestration design is primarily governed by requirement of heat gain and heat loss, ventilation and daylighting, the important components of a window are the glazing systems and shading devices. So, glazing system and shading devices becomes as an integral part and which serves to satisfy the needs of the occupant using the interior spaces with daylighting, ventilation, heat gain and heat loss. Primary component of windows which have significant impact on energy and cost of building for which guidelines are provided in this section are as follows: window size, placement, type of glazing that should be chosen and the frame, U value of the frame, shading external and internal. So, window size and placement, height of window head, the higher the window head the deeper will be the penetration of daylight. So, the daylight increases as you go higher level. So, keeping higher lintel levels will promote higher penetration of daylight inside your spaces, but it also will restrict you from having operation on the higher end. So, it is ideal to keep mobile windows limiting to certain heights, say 7 feet and above that if your space requires good amount of daylighting, it is better to go for fixed glazing system which cannot be operated above certain levels because of height restrictions. Some of the windows are strip windows which is being horizontally laid, or windows which has good amount of height. The height from floor to bottom of the window is called, this level is called sill level and this is called the window height, and this level in which the top of the window lies is called lintel level. So, sill height, height from floor to the bottom of the window. The optimum sill for a good illumination as well as for good ventilation should be between illumination workspace and head level of a person. Carrying out any task, the suitable work plane levels are to be 1 to 0.3 meter high respectively. Depending on such factors, you need to decide your sill heights. Strip window provide more uniform daylight. Punched window should be paired with work areas to avoid creating contrast of light and dark spaces. So, if you are going to have a strip window which is horizontally placed, that is going to light up your room more evenly or uniformly, but if you are going to have puncture opening, that is very random openings in your walls, it is going to create some spots are going to be much more brighter whereas some spots are going to be much darker. So, you need to consider which type of window design will suit your needs and you need to choose it wisely. And moving to glazing system, the window size should be kept minimum in hot and dry regions. The primary property of the glazing system that impacts energy are visible reflectance affecting heat and light reflection, and thermal resistance or U value affecting to the conduction heat gains, solar heat gains affecting directance solar gain, spectral selectivity affecting daylight and heat gain. So, depending on which climatic zone, you can choose type of glazing systems that can be used. For a hot and dry climate where the solar radiation is very high, the windows or percentage of glazing system that has to be used should be kept in minimum. And also the glazing color affects the thermal and visual property of the glazing system and thus energy use. If you are going to keep a dark colored glass on the exterior of a hotter region, it is going to absorb lot of heat energy and it is going to eventually start dissipating it inside to your interior spaces through conduction and long wave radiation. So, if according to the climatic condition, you need to change the color of your glazing systems. The primary property of glazing that impact energy are visual reflectance, thermal transmittance, solar heat gain, spectral selectivity, glazing color. The same that we have just saw is been summarized under glass as well. Visual reflectance or daylight reflectance, this is the percentage of incident light that is reflected back. Most manufacturers provide both side reflectance, exterior daytime view and the interior reflectance, interior mirror image at night. This is like the amount of reflectance that a glass can have. So, it is like an additional coating to your glass which is made by lot of manufacturers nowadays. During your night times, your windows will become like highly reflective surface to the exterior. So, no one can from the exterior can see what is happening inside, whereas it becomes the reverse during your daytime. Treatments such as metallic coating increase the reflectance. Reflective glazing reflects a large portion of solar radiation incident on it, thereby restricting heat gains inside the building, which is advantageous. So, if you are designing in a hotter climate, this type of reflectivity is very much appreciated. So, it can reflect lot of incident solar radiation that is falling on the glazing system. So, disadvantages: this reflective glazing allows low visible transmittance and thus minimum daylight ingression. Even though it has an advantage of bouncing back the incident solar radiation, it reduces the ingress of daylighting, which is also very much essential for any interior space. An ideal spectral selective glazing admits only the part of sun's energy that is useful for daylighting. So, it can be chosen ideally so that solar radiation will be reflected and only the natural light, daylight, will be transmitted inside. These are different types of glasses and its U value and percentage of visible light transmittance that happens. So, these are clear glass, body tinted, hard coated solar control glass, soft coated solar control glass, low E glass, solar control plus low E. So, low E is a coating that is being added to your glazing system. So, if it is a solar control plus low E coating glass, it can be beneficial to use it in hotter climates or climatic condition with longer summer months. Typical optical and thermal property for high performance glazing options. So, glazing types and materials. The advanced glazing includes double and triple pane windows with coating such as low E, which is low emissivity, and spectral selective heat absorption tinted or reflective gas filled windows and windows based on combination of these options. So, depending on the climatic condition, you can even go for double glazed systems or triple glazed systems, which means there is two glass planes which is kept little further from each other, which is filled with air cavity or with aerosol or some type of gas. So, that becomes double glazing system. In a triple glazing system, there is three glasses which is separated in between with air cavities, which is again filled with a gas or air. The creation of vacuum or partial vacuum in the cavity of a double glazed unit and the use of aerogel to fill the cavity can lower the U value considerably. Air space between glass layers, thermal resistance provided by the air gap between the glass layers increased with increase in cavity width up to 12 mm. The higher the air cavity and the type of double or triple insulation, lowers the U value, which are advantages for colder climatic regions. So, if you are designing say a building in a place like London or Scotland, you might go for double or even triple glazing systems, which will reduce your U value, which will increase the resistance of the windows from fluctuation or colder temperature that is present on the exterior. This is how single glazing is. So, there is one glass and this is your home and this is outside. The heat is leaving like this, and when it is a double glazing, you have an insulation layer or a gas which is being kept in between two planes of glass. So, this is your interior space and this is your exterior space. Heat that is flowing gets trapped inside the insulation and mostly it's bounced back towards the interior, and only very small amount is being escaped outside. So, these are different types of glazing materials and different combinations how it can be used. Latest trends in glazing units are: switchable glazing will enable the user to change the optical or thermal property of sealed glazed units. The most useful and potential application of switchable property is the chromogenic phenomena, in which material change their reflectivity and absorptivity. Example of chromogenic process are thermochromic, electrochromic and photochromic material. So, these are latest trends which is being developed in glazing, which is able to change the thermal chromatic property of the glazing system itself. Next is evacuated glazing. Evacuated sealed insulated glazing is designed to achieve higher level of thermal performance by using a vacuum to inhibit any kind of conductivity or convection heat losses. This is ideal for colder regions as well, to reduce the heat loss. So, we are keeping two glazing system and it is being filled with certain amount of gas which forms this evacuated glazing system. Flip windows for improved performance in summer and winter. It also has two performance. It can be flipped to reduce the heat loss during winter and to improve the heat loss during summers. The double plane absorptivity glazing system for hot climate has a useful feature for regions of hot and dry climate having both heating and cooling seasons. If there is a climatic condition which demands for both space heating and space cooling, this type of glazing system is ideal. So, next is solar control glazing. They are very effective against heat flow across the window, but can reduce transmission of light inside the space. So, this type of glazing, solar control, is it reflects the most of the incident solar radiation that is being falling on surface of the glazing system, but one disadvantage is it reduces the ingress of daylighting. So, let us now summarize the whole presentation that we saw as learning outcomes. First, we saw both types of envelopes, wall, roofs and windows, and then we moved in brief discussion about various wall system, windows and glazings, and then we saw about types of glazing systems and latest trends in glazing systems, and finally, we saw about solar control glazing. Now, questions. What is an envelope? What are the different systems that contribute to the envelope design? Explain in detail about various wall systems typically used in a climatic zone. Importance of glazing system and its uses. What are the latest developing trends in glass? Thank you.